Jonathan.
Matt Black, Cold
Cuts. Cold Cuts on the mix.
We're going to talk about your whole history, I guess, the last 30 years for you guys. And yeah, maybe even going to start by taking you back to when exactly you first met, which was in a Soho record shop, was it not, first of all?
That's right. I was working in Reckless Records in Berwick Street, which is still there to this day, still serving vinyl heads with a fix. And Matt came in, had a cassette with him.
Yeah, vinyl is having a resurgence now. And it just thinking about Reckless Records, record shops were places where you met other heads.
Absolutely.
Who were really into music. It was a physical space, and meeting John there, that was the start of our relationship, really. John was working there. He actually sold me a bootleg copy of Maceo and the Max Across the Tracks, which is a sort of must-have rare groove record.
Under-the-counter job.
Which is what we did later with Say Kids, our first record.
Say Kids, what time is it?
Rupert Bear was looking for something to do, or someone to play with, or just something really exciting and dangerous to happen.
The first track, Say Kids, was just done on cassette. And
literally cassette tape.
Literally, and literally edited with a pause button.
Four-track cassette.
But in the backing track was done on a two-track stereo cassette using the mechanical pause button, and which was a thing me and my mates had worked out at college as a simple way of doing edits. And then, yeah, four-track Yamaha MT-44, I think it might have been called. So you could take the cassette, put it in that, and then add another two tracks. But basically it was cassette, mixer and turntables.
And some effects. A Maxim, was it, Matt? Maxim delay?
I think we got that after, though. Say Kids is just a turntable cut up. And yeah, that was, I'd say, totally inspired by the Dordian Steinsky.
88, you played at Shoom, the early acid house club. And
Danny Rampling was on Kiss, so we were all on the Kiss FM, the pirate station. And he invited us to go down and partake of Shoom, yeah, which was.
And then you kind of started making more housey tunes, I guess, as well, with Doctor in the House. And
I think John and I, we were always into a lot of different sorts of music, and we feel perhaps we're sort of children of John Peel, who made being into a lot of different styles of music cool, rather than just be, oh, I'm just into punk, or I'm just into hip-hop. And then the New York and hip-hop and Dordian Steinsky style of mixing let us literally mix a lot of different influences together. So you know, looking back at Doctor in the House, it was a pretty mad record with a house beat, acid house bass line, but then all these hip-hop and other cartoon reggae samples mixed over the top. So it's montage, it's mashup, it's not just one style. But certainly 1987, 1988,
yeah,
the house thing was really gathering a lot of energy, and we loved it.
Well, Doctor in the House smashed into the UK top 10, didn't it? And then the kind of follow-up with Yaz, The Only Way Is Up, that you produced, got to number one. Suddenly you were kind of in the mainstream, in a sense. What was it like to have been catapulted into the mainstream of the music industry?
It was,
a bit odd.
Yeah. Square peg, round hole comes to mind, really.
One review I remember saying, Matt and John are unlikely pop stars, and they know it, which I think perhaps we did know. But then, Johnny Rotten was probably an unlikely pop star as well, and so is a lot of other people. So sometimes, it's us weirdos and outsiders who come up with something a little bit different. And if it's the right place, the right time, the conditions are right, suddenly you're on top of the pops, and it is quite mad, but we enjoyed it all.
It's February 1988, and it's the blonde candy floss, the ever so talented Yaz with Cold Cut, Doctor in the House.
What gave you the inspiration for starting your own label, Ninja Tune?
I think by that time, actually, the machinations of the industry had started to
wear
us down and bear heavy on the shoulder. And, the second album, we struggled to convince the record label about certain things. In particular, struggled to convince them about the use of multimedia, which, you know, was an early part and becoming more important for us. And we went off, you know, frustrated, off to Japan to tour with Norman Cook and Lindy Layton, Beats International. And we did like 14 shows in 13 days, living on bento boxes. And it was just such a different cultural experience, just an amazing sort of input of deep, you know, ancient traditions and crazy futuristic shit combined together. And just got into the whole ninja aspect. We felt like ninjas, really. And Matt found a cut out and keep sort of how to be ninja thing.
A little magazine, cut out ninjas. And John was saying he'd been sort of zoned out, tranced out one night, so we were a bit spaced out. And watching this ninja film, but with the sound down, you have it with some music on, which is always good. It's like, yeah, this is a lick. This is something that we could use. So we recycled the ninja idea. Obviously, we're not, well, not killer ninjas, but we're music ninjas.
We're the kind of ninja that can turn ourselves into diaphanous sheets of silk and slip under doors.
Stealthily.
So I've heard. Why did your major label deals come to an end?
You know, without going into all the sort of grief of that, it happens. If you look back, you can see the sort of thing happens more times. Yeah, some people come with some fresh thing from the underground. It's a new thing. Hipsters flop onto it because they want something new. It gets really popular, and then the business companies see that they've got a new product here which they can sell, and they're very used to doing that, but they sort of want you to fit into their sausage shape, which is what they're used to selling. So they come back and say, yeah, can you just make some more like those first ones, because those sold and now we can sell some more of them. And we like, well, actually we don't want to do that, and we really don't know how to do it, because each one just came from, you know, mysterious magical processes, not from cranking some machine handle round again. So there that came attention, and you know, you find like, well, you've signed this contract, even though your lawyer, you've paid a lot of money, is sort of negotiated for, you find that actually the contract's really shit. You can't go back to releasing stuff under your own name because they own that name, and you're sort of at their mercy. So Ninja was a Technicolor escape pod to blast out of that, because there was one way out, which was that we could release music under different names. So we started the DJ Food, the Bogus Order identities, so that we could keep experimenting and putting out other stuff, which wasn't just a rerun of The Only Way Is Up.
So you couldn't use the Cold Cut name for a few years, so you had these other names like Bogus Aliases. Order and, and Ninja was kick-started off the back of those kind of beats and breaks kind of releases and stuff. What was the process of getting other artists involved in the label to start with?
It's a natural, just happened, didn't it?
They kind of gravitated towards us, I think, you know.
I think we were quite loud about the fact we were pissed off. We hadn't got paid what was due to us, and we wanted to start a label where we had control, and we would make sure that we got paid fairly, and at least it would be, if it was a success or not, at least it would be our own responsibility. And that, you know, labels should pay artists what was agreed and what was owed. So as a lot of artists have had the experience of getting shafted over, they say, well, maybe we'll, these guys, they're artists themselves, maybe they'll give us a better deal.
Why were you interested in the visual element as well as the music?
I think we'd always been, you know, people are interested in visuals. Those of us who are lucky enough to have eyes to go with our ears. And, you know, the sleeve of Doctor in the House was a bit of an old shoebox. It was a pattern from a 50s shoebox that John had collected. So we were actually magpies of visual samples as well. John had a background in visual arts as well.
Yeah, and also there's a history from back from the days of Jimi Hendrix and Pink Floyd, working both with visual artists and working with visuals. And so it's the raves with the laser shows and et cetera, et cetera. Also, it's it's something to hide behind in some ways. You know,
don't look
the bigger
at us.
The stage. Back in the day, we'd be tucked in the corner of the warehouse, you know, DJing, and that's properly comfortable there. And it was about the people on the dance floor. It wasn't about the DJ. And that dynamic changed and has continued to change and evolve in many different ways.
The business understands, like, the pop star at the front of the stage. So they want you to do that. So when dance music took off, they naturally tried to force that onto any kind of live performance or gig type of format. But we didn't feel it was right. So we thought, actually, if we give people visuals to look at, then that's a natural complement to the music and it's taking the attention away from us. We don't have to be front men in the conventional way.
You guys were kind of early adopters on the internet and did some early live streams from your London HQ, did you not?
That was a project called Pirate TV that when we were in this cool building in Winchester Wharf by the Thames. And then it was pretty cool because the building filled up with various like types of bods and weird little companies, and one of them were called Obsolete, and they got the gig to do Levi's first website. And Levi's paid for a high-speed line into the building, which was...
This is like mid-90s, isn't
it? Early 90s. And what Obsolete did, which was very generous, was that they shared this line with the other companies in the building. They were really into Ninja Tune. They were a bunch of heads. And a guy called Heath Bunting, who's a very interesting, still going activist artist guy, he came and wired us up onto email. And we started doing these broadcasts, netcasts, or streaming, as you call it now.
And this was probably when most people who started up Boiler Room were still in kindergarten.
Probably. But you know, it was like, I don't know if you remember Max Headroom. Do you remember the pilot episode, 20 Minutes into the Future, which is the one that set up how he's created? Well, in that, there's this wicked old, there's a scene with this old punk couple, and they run a pirate TV station out of an old bus. And I thought, yeah, that's cool. We could be a pirate TV station.
We
with the internet, you could do that. So we jumped on that. We did some quite good stuff as well that, you know, politically, we're always asked, like, you know, do you think music can be political? And of course the answer is fuck yeah, you just look at history. Yes. Every revolution needs a good soundtrack. But those protests like the Reclaim the Streets and the May Day protests were going on. They weren't really being covered on mainstream TV. And if you've ever had first experience of anything which is on the news, you usually find that what they report is nothing like what's actually happening. So we had a crew of mates, activists, who would go out and film stuff at those protests and then come back and we'd stream it out on Pirate TV. Mixing it with music, mixing it up, doing a live commentary. We taught a bunch of other people to do it as well, which I'm quite proud of. Like these, even from Palestine, they were doing like streaming. We turned some people onto it. We also had Radiohead guest on a couple of shows, which was pretty exciting. This guy Tim Brand, who is from Dread Zone, was one of our Pirate TV jammers, and he was working with this thing, Res Rocket Surfer, who were doing this internet jamming project. But he was also friends with Radiohead and he went and wired them up and got them on to do Pirate TV. That was wicked. One of the guys in the building is called James Stevens. He used to sell Mac gear really cheap. And he sold us our first proper audiovisual sampling card, which was called a Video Vision Radius. It was a card for your Mac and you could plug in a video recorder and record the sound and the visual into the machine as audiovisual samples and do stuff with it. So we're like, great, okay, let's start doing audiovisual cut-up. And so we worked with Stuart to do that. And that the end result of that was the Natural Rhythm Trilogy, the best which known one of which is Timber. And all respect to Stuart, actually, for, you know, being the main architect behind that. But it was a team effort. But that was really, we like realized we created something new and exciting with that.
And Timber, for those who haven't seen it, it's kind of the hook, if you like, is based around a kind of chainsaw
lead guitar
chainsawing down the rainforest.
Yeah,
absolutely. And yeah,
with the audio visual montage, the effect of it was, I suppose, an environmental activist record, if you like. It was showing the rainforest being cut down, destruction being a bad thing.
It was an audiovisual poem. The other key element in that was the
beautiful woman,
this beautiful native woman singing a sort of rather sad sounding ululation. It's a good hook. Oh, yeah. You know, John and I used to joke sometimes that, you know, what you want for a hit is something heavy, something stupid, like a heavy beat and then some stupid or catchy melody on top, or, you know, a nice bit of female vocal and a heavy beat is also, you could analyze quite a few hits of the last 30 years and like that. But that was a really good sample. It made sense for that to be the next type of cut up, basically. And we used to call it the new hip hop. And then that was done in Premiere, where you chop up little bits of samples and you stick them together on the timeline. And it's cool, but it's very painstaking. We thought it'd be much better to have something that was more like a turntable or a piano, an instrument for audiovisual samples, so that we could do this live and play it like an instrument. So for that, we developed this bit of software, VJam.
Cold cuts on the mix.
Since early on, you were doing your Solid Steel radio show every week, or very, very regular, and mixing together all sorts of different music from different styles. How did this help when embarking on your 70 Minutes of Madness Journeys by DJ comp?
It was, I suppose, it made the stock in sort of cooking terms. You know, the four of us DJing together, so PC, Patrick, and Strictly Kev, Matt and I, you know, doing those shows, there was a kind of, there was a show and tell element to it. There was a healthy competitive element to it as well. And we were very lucky at the time with Kiss that Gordon ran the kit, Gordon Mack, who ran the station, actually allowed us quite regularly to have a show, 2-hour show, without any adverts. And, you know, he didn't really interfere in terms of the musical content. He would occasionally say things like, can't you play, you know, three weird ones and then play something that they know? But, you know, to have a broadcast station that allowed you to do that at that time was quite rare. And so that and clubbing and Stealth, which was a club that we ran, Ninja Club that we ran.
Where we did four-deck mixing.
Yeah, the four-deck mixing thing,
Blue Note, Hoxton Square, wasn't it?
Yeah. So those were all important in sort of developing a lot of the themes that ran through, you know, Journeys by DJs.
Did you guys properly see the digital revolution coming with vinyl sales dropping through the floor because people were sharing digital files and so on and so forth? And how did you adapt the label to the digital era of the 21st century?
We totally saw it coming, man. I mean, it was in the Ninja Tune building. Upstairs was a little company called Cerberus Digital Jukebox. This guy Ricky Agar, I think he was called. That was his thing. And he was early on to this idea that music could be made into MP3s and shared over the net. There was a thing called the IUMA, the Internet Underground Music Archive, with tons of bands that you've never heard of sharing their MP3s, because they were the geeky ones. They were the ones that got it first. The well-known bands were all on major labels. They wouldn't find out about this for some years. And he had a conference where he called in various record label bods into the building. And I was there, and he explained that this was going to happen. People were going to be sending music through the internet. And unless the record companies understood that and found a way to make it work, it would really fucking hurt them.
And the major label people didn't believe it.
No, the sort of uniform blank face was a sight to behold. But yeah, we were plugged into that, and like I say, we were in the building with a bunch of other companies that were early in on this, and it seemed quite clear that this was going to change things.
This song called Guts.
Space Journey, you gave away all the parts or stems.
Yeah, that's right. We used to dance with DJ Food as well. We gave away a floppy disk for the younger people about you. That was a format that could contain digital information.
But this was before Native Instruments or whoever made a big thing about stems as well. Was it way before?
Well, you can trace it back to DJ Food, because DJ Food, the idea of that was food for DJs. So we're like, okay, here's a bunch of samples for you to manipulate. We've chopped some of them into tracks, which you can scratch and mix, but they're fundamentally building blocks for you to interact and do stuff with. We're going to say, going back to DJs as well, what's a DJ? It's a prototype interactive music user. Someone who doesn't just, you say, disc jockeys play records, DJs play with records. And so taking our tracks, breaking them down to the component parts, was something we wanted to do for our live shows, so that we could use our DJAM software to do live, effectively live performances, live remixes of our own tracks. And then he thought, well, actually, if we give this out to people, maybe they'll do some different stuff with it that we wouldn't think of. So it's another way of sharing things. And that Creative Commons open source mentality is something that, you know, we support as well, because
it's important. We tried to persuade the Rolling Stones to do it. We had a very funny meeting with their lawyer where they wanted to remix one of their tracks, and they put so many conditions on doing the remix, like we had to go to their studio in New York, we couldn't take any parts out of the studio, la 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 la,
sign here in blood.
And we just got really frustrated, so we suggested to them that they just release the acapellas into the ether, and before they know it, they would probably have some of the best remixes in the world. They could just grab all those remixes, comp them, put them out. Fantastic story, job done. The guy's face just couldn't hack it. It's so
funny. Does compute? They should so have done that.
I know. That's it. Would have been brilliant.
Cool. Babylon always wants to pile on the control. They think by controlling and squeezing, they'll get more. But actually, more time they get less, and it just it escapes from their hands, and what you're left with is really dry. It's, I say, open source mentality is more about, this actually belongs to everyone. Why don't you just stop trying to monopolize it, accept that it belongs to everyone, and see what happens?
You guys are total pioneers. Thanks for your outstanding contribution, and long may it continue.
Well, thank you very much. And thanks to DJ Magazine for the support over the years as well. Enough respect.
Thanks a lot, Matt and John. Cheers.
Thank you very much.